How's that?
Hello, guys, and welcome to Behind the Bunker, episode 494, podcast 374. If you're wondering, wow, those numbers are high, they are. Podcast or episode number 494 means we're five away from 500, ladies and gentlemen. So stay tuned. We're going to be doing some fun things on our 500th anniversary. If you guys are new to the show, you guys are tuning in to listen to a weekly paintball podcast that we record live. We stream it on Facebook and on YouTube. So thank you guys for joining in. With me, my name is Todd Ansich, but with me, I also have Joe Kimson from Flaggarters Paintball joining.
Greetings and thanks for tuning in tonight to beautiful Behind the Bunker. We like the whole Midwest, Ontario, Quebec, all into the Midwest states. We're in for a big storm, apparently. So we'll see what happens, whether there's a snow day tomorrow or not. But thanks for tuning in and watching.
Yeah, so hopefully our internet stays strong and stays with us for the next hour. Do a shout out, guys. Post up in the live chat if you guys are watching. Nice to see Dwayne King, Kevin in YouTube. Then we have Maureen Brown. Nice to see you, George. Hey, Bobby Douse, Dan and Hardy, and Simeon, all you guys. So what about Gavin Sharma? Is he in the live chat or is he on the show?
I'm in a little column A, little column B. Thank you so much, folks, for tuning in. Snowmageddon is about to hit us, and that's okay. So strap in, keep warm, and listen to the show or watch the show. But make sure you hit that like and share button so everybody else can huddle down and enjoy some quality entertainment that we call Behind the Bunker on Monday night.
I don't know if I can hold. I don't think I can let that one go. You called Behind the Bunker quality entertainment, Gavin. That's pushing
well,
it.
Okay, we'll assess it by the end of the evening. But now, we're on a high note, and this is quality intro.
This coming from the guy who's made the best of the last 2 weeks.
That's right, and I'm looking for a three-peat, baby. That's right. Follow me all night, because this is the highlight right here, the highlight reel, the moneymaker. Maybe. And who else do we have on the show, Todd?
Yeah, who else is on the show? We have someone in Studio Green.
Yes, we do.
That's me, but, he says.
Hang on a sec. I'm a little confused, though, because you just gave Gavin heck
mm-hmm.
for saying quality show. But at the beginning, you said we were going to have a lot of fun. So,
I did,
you know.
Yeah, but fun's not necessarily quality.
Like, I guess.
Maureen Brown in the live chat says low quality is still quality.
It is a type of quality. That
semantics.
Is true. She's not wrong, that's for sure.
Yeah. So, nice to see all you guys in here. Dan and Hardy says they're having rolling blackouts in Texas right now. Bab Spisser says behind the snowbank. Brian Foster, Gavin's beard will keep him safe.
That's right.
It's getting pretty bushy.
It sure is, Skip. And this will remain until we at least hit orange. So I think we are open so I can get a haircut eventually if I can get an appointment. But this bad boy's going to stay for a little bit. It's bringing us good luck. And, it's filtering out all the losers and, all of the quality guests tune into Behind the Bunker. So if you would like to share this to your quality guests and friends, make sure you hit that like and share and comment, because we are watching you in the chat. And this is an interactive show, so you are a part of it. Beard or no beard, we're watching you in the chat.
Well, for those of you that are watching, if you saw Gavin pop up on a social media app, maybe a singles app, how fast would you swipe? I mean, in which direction, I guess I should ask.
I'm following. You know what? Okay, so in Canada right now, Canada, it's Family Day, but we just left Valentine's Day. So I've been checking my dating apps, both my Christian Mingle, my J-Date, and my Hindu Hookup.
That's great.
I'm sure it's going to explode this evening.
You're on the dating apps. We'll move on in a second, but are they busy right now with Valentine's Day passing? Like, was there a little uptick?
Well, my Hindu Hookup, yes.
Jesus. Maybe we'll leave this for the after show then.
For sure.
Yeah, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, we got lots to get to on the show tonight. We have a segment from The Vault. I took a quick video as well tonight, and there is a couple other videos to watch tonight. Tonight's topic we're going to be discussing later on, if I can find it here. There it is. Want to know what other sports you guys quit or gave up on when you found paintball. I know I unfortunately did. One of the responses that I think wins the show tonight on that, Real Bag of Chips says, is marriage a sport? Good for you, sir.
Contact.
Yeah, yeah. Every Thursday, guys, if there is a possibility, we're trying to release highlights from the podcast. So if you guys missed the show, hopefully you'll be able to catch those. If you can't catch the highlights, go ahead and download us anywhere that you get your podcast from. And I have to say this, Australia. What the heck is going on with Australia? Our podcast number had a good spike this week. It was an extra 800 guys that download or people that downloaded it from Australia. I was looking through our numbers, wondering why we had a bit of a blip and where they came from. So someone in Australia has been sharing this podcast.
But let's be honest. It was probably 800 guys or maybe 799 guys with one girl.
Well, we have some female viewers.
Yes. And we do our best to alienate them every week.
Yes. Yes, yes, we do. Couple things I want to talk to you guys about. The Jeremy Somm sniper incident. If you guys haven't watched that, go check it out. It is live on paintball.media's Patreon page. Go check that out. A lot of you guys have been asking for patches. I am down to my last small handful. If you want them, they're $10 each. Plus postage, just send us a message through all the social medias. And there we go. I saw George Hay on the live chat.
Hey.
This was sent in by Zane Smith. I don't know if you guys have seen this before. Maybe George has. But these are croc bathing suit.
They're actually called croc jocks.
Croc jocks. There you go.
For the love of God.
No kidding. You can't not see that now. World at War, Crimson Dawn, ladies and gentlemen. That's happening April 9th to 11th. That is Behind the Bunker and Joe Kimson's sanctioned game. Make sure you guys head on over where?
Where is it? It's in French Lick.
French Lick. Save the date, 2021. Here is all the Mission Masters games. Make sure you guys check those out. And Brandon B-Rad Page, make sure you sign up for Team Red when you're playing Super Game Indiana at Sherwood Forest. That's in June 25th to 27th. Then we have Lake Norman Paintball, Airsoft, and Axe Throwing, Love versus War. And that was an awesome game held yesterday. Hopefully you guys attended that. April 17th to 18th, Xbox versus PlayStation. That's at our field, Fort Knox. Make sure you guys check that one out. That's a new poster for us today. Alien versus Predators, April 24th to 25th. Total Carnage, that's a Mission Masters game at Black Ops Paintball. Make sure you guys play for our friend the Command Bros when you guys play the Jurassic game on March 26th to the 28th. And last but not least, March 26th to 28th, here's Jurassic as well. Make sure you guys head on over there and check that out. And that's all I got in the news for now and all the upcoming events. If you guys would like your posters on the show, all you got to do is drop your logo on it and help us promote, and we'll get you up on our show. Awesome. So you guys ready for a show tonight?
Nope.
No? Okay. Well, fill that mason jar. We're going to need you shortly. Before we do anything else, oh, you did. Good for you. Why don't we head on over? Joe does his From the Vault segment. Why don't we get to that, ladies and gentlemen? When we get back, we'll have lots more.
It's Joe from Flaggers Paintball here with another segment of From the Vault, where we go back in history, back into the early days of paintball. Today is no different. Today we are going to look at some Splatball marking pellets from the National Survival Game. This genuine package came with 120 paintballs, so it had 12 tubes, each with 10 red paintballs. This is when the National Survival Game switched from oil-based paintballs to likely water-soluble paintballs as we know them now. Kind of neat. They had National Survival Game as a registered trademark, Splatball as a registered trademark, and Splatmaster as a registered trademark. So how we got to calling them paintballs. Interesting, when they were originally called by the National Survival Game as splatballs. Many fields in the early days were called war games, adventure games, or splatball. Anyway, you've been watching Behind the Bunker. See you next time. Pew, pew.
And me as an owner, I know that I kind of stay in the shadows and make sure everything's running pretty smooth. Us older guys have to be mentors for these young men growing up, and I really believe that that's our position is we have the responsibility to help this new generation come up. Last year was a fair season, and we've been in this little rut, I guess. A lot of rumors that we couldn't get over this hump, and you know, we just kept working. You know, we won one event, that was expected from me, but when we won two, that was just unbelievable. I couldn't be more proud of these young men. I am Alex Martinez, I am X Factor, and these are my boys, and we are family.
So that was some of my paintballs, some Splatmaster rounds I have in a box. I do have a Splatmaster pistol that I could do a vault sometime. I think I've done one already, but I'm sure we could bring it back again. But it's a Splatmaster. So those are the first generations of water-soluble paintballs that came after the oil base. So they were, I guess, bought and sold, distributed by National Survival Game. So kind of cool. People are wondering about the Legos, so we have some sort of Harry Potter something. The Millennium Falcon is there, James Bond car, and this is a Stranger Things Lego set. So there's some Lego behind
me. Oh, yeah. Remember when Stranger Things was such a huge thing?
It is. It's the Upside Down. So it's kind of cool.
Yeah. Very
so
cool.
So that was that. So we'll do another vault for next week, and away we go.
Since Gavin and Josh haven't said it, ladies and gentlemen, make sure you hit that like and share button if you're watching us on Facebook. Heck, even share us to any of your paintball groups that you belong to. And if you're watching us on YouTube, the way to support us there is to obviously hit the like button, comment, and even hit the notification bell. Hell, even subscribe if you want to commit that much of to our relationship. Gavin, are you ready for some mail time?
Am I ever?
Mail time. Mail time. Mail time.
The mail's here.
That's right, ladies and gentlemen, it is mail time. So it is a holiday here in Canada, but the mailman still delivers. I get to rip open my sack and read some of the correspondence, folks, that you, my friends, have sent in. So the first one comes to us from Zane, the insane Zaniac Smith. And it was a picture question. I'm not sure if you have it loaded, but it's okay. It had to do with our friend Joseph B. Kimpson wearing a sheriff outfit, and there's something on top of his head.
Right here?
That's it right there. I think that's Joe. Is that Joe?
It's a badger?
Who is that? And tell us a little about what's going on there.
1980, I don't know when it was, 1995 probably. We're reading the Toronto Sun. The Toronto Sun did do an article.
How come you're only one page in?
Page 3, baby.
On the article, I still have the newspaper. So I think that is when the Toronto Sun came down and they did an article on flag raiders, and it was published in the Toronto Sun. So I believe we were reading that particular issue because I wasn't a big Sun reader. Although the Sun was probably one of the only daily print publications that had countless, you know, in the heyday, in the early 80s, 83, 84, 85, 86, there was pages and pages at the end of the Sun of paintball places that, you know, full page Great Canadian Adventure Game, Survival Game, you know, paintball advertisements in the newspaper. Now you don't see that anymore because print media
is dead.
It's really not a thing anymore. But back in the day, the Sun was the place to advertise because it was a certain demographic that you were targeting. In paintball.
Good for you, Brian Foster. He says, don't read directly into the Sun. Sorry, I don't know why. Same. I giggled into that.
That was a good one.
Awesome. Yeah, that's our friend Joseph reading. He's literate. And looking at the news publication. Good for him. So the next question comes to us from Jason Diff, and he wants to know, not sure if this has been ever asked before, but how did the four of you all come together to entertain us and become involved in paintball? So how did we all connect?
Well, first there was a misunderstanding.
Must be so.
And then I think Joe was low on his rent. Yeah, that's a good question. How did we all get together?
How did we get together? I started Flaggers as a marketing project, and we used to go to a bar, and then my sister somehow met Todd. But before that, Gavin came to play paintball. Then we saw him at the movie because we go to the movie. Then we recruited Gavin to come work for us because he was awesome. And Josh became a paintball player. Then Todd had an idea, or someone had an idea to do a podcast, or no, it wasn't podcast, weren't invented, but Behind the Bunker, do a live stream paintball show. We called it Behind the Bunker and started as Todd and I, and then Josh and Gavin came in, and now it's what this is.
Yeah. I mean, there's probably a little more to the story, but that's the Reader's Digest about the basic thing.
Actually a Twitter version.
Yeah,
there's 240 characters there. You're good.
Yeah, we've been doing this for an awful long time, though. Like, we've known each other for an awful long time. I think Joe, I've probably known the longest. Gavin, a short time later, because you were at the field the same time I was coming out to the field. Josh, I don't remember when I met Josh, but how long have you been going to the field?
Well, it was probably around 2003 or 2004.
Hmm. Okay.
Yeah, Gavin, you have that. Sorry, I don't need to point. You have that green camo with the sheriff on it, don't you?
I do. Yeah, the patches, the whole thing. Yeah, that's Palm Beach County Sheriff's Department. Yeah,
that's pretty cool stuff. We should wear that.
And then,
if I can find it, yeah,
mm-hmm. I know where mine is.
And then Matt, the Crypt, the producer of the show, he came out maybe the first time I came out. No, but shortly thereafter. So it would have been probably the first season.
I didn't realize that this was that kind of show.
It's all inclusive. It's okay.
Not that there's anything wrong with that, Zuby.
Exactly.
No, just give me a heads up next time.
Dane and Hardy says we should make a movie about Behind the Bunker.
We do every Monday.
Okay, so you know what? I will piggyback on that question. We're doing a BTB movie, and we get to choose the person who's going to play you.
Oh,
in
good
the movie.
Question. You know, ladies and gentlemen, okay, all you ladies and gentlemen that follow us on social media, and we ask you for your questions. Why can't you come up with questions like this, Gavin?
Oh, that's
good
a
for you.
Question.
Very well.
Gavin, all right, over the BTB, doing all the heavy lifting.
The BTB movie, who is the cast? Pick it.
Who is the Hollywood cast? That's good.
I would
who's
like.
Who's going to play each of us?
I would like.
No, don't say anything. Okay. Don't say anything. Honestly, we will pin this.
Okay.
We'll come back to it next week and see what everybody's contributions in terms of who's going to play us in the BTB movie.
Love it. Bab Spicer says Brokeback Bunker, the movie. Hey, now. We don't make fun of you, Bab. Very good. And I like Mike says Matt Damon. I'm going to choose that's who's playing me is Matt Damon.
All right. Don't.
I'm just kidding.
Plant anything, right? You know, next week we're definitely going to revisit this. I would love to hear who's going to play each and every one of us in the BTB cast.
Yeah.
All right. So I'm going to move on to the next question if I can. So Oliver Powell wants, his question is, I want to get my son into paintball. So what's good gun/equipment to buy for somebody just starting out? What would you guys recommend for getting somebody?
How old is his son, does he say?
I guess his son's 13 or 14.
Okay.
Oh,
so
really?
I think.
So why don't we do, you know, the sort of the age and stage in terms of, you know, somebody who can get into.
Sorry, I'm reading the live chat.
Somebody who can get into the sport. So let's say, okay, a 10-year-old versus a teenager.
Yeah.
So what would your recommendations be for a setup for somebody who just wants to get into the sport? Just to clarify this a bit, he wants to get his son into the sport. So if you want to get your child into the sport, what's the best thing you can do?
Yeah.
What's the best setup?
It's funny, a year and a half ago, you and Joe would have swore up and down with a Tippmann Cronus. But that has since changed. But go ahead and say what you guys are going to say now.
Oliver is sort of a scenario type player, so I would suggest that he buy his son a Stormer Elite. Then he can flip-flop back and forth between Hopper Fed and Mag Fed. And if he's just starting out, he can run it with a hopper because it's much less complicated. And I think just a JT Thermo Spectra would be a great mask to get him started. And a basic pod pack and maybe a remote and just go from there. And of course, sturdy footwear.
Do you think a remote though might be too much for a new person?
I don't know. It depends on how big the kid is, and it certainly will lighten his gun up a lot. Right. Running a remote, they do complicate things a little bit, but you know, I don't think.
Could you imagine giving 100 rental guys? And I'm not trying to be disrespectful, but 100 rental guys, all guns that have remotes.
No.
How much of a gong show that'd be? It'd be one thing if you had your son, because you'd be watching over him and you'd be able to teach him. But oh man. 100 rental guys, they'd be all tangled. They wouldn't even make it to the field.
There'd be airlines swirling around. There'd be people getting concussed with airlines, guns left out on the field, and the guys would get pulled back onto the field.
Yeah, getting crazy caught on trees.
Yeah.
I hurt. So I would, you know what, I would take sort of a different approach. So I do like the idea of getting your own gear, customizing it a little bit. But I wouldn't jump right into the marker territory at this point. So if you want to get your child into the sport, I think a solid pair of goggles that they have their own, sturdy footwear, as my friend Joseph is a great proponent of, and some camouflage and protection, because you don't know if this is going to be it for them, if they're going to like it, if they're going to continue with it, right? So you don't want to get heavily invested in it. And there is, honestly, there's nothing wrong with a rental marker. Right, so it is absolutely important to make sure you have a goggle system that's not going to fog, that is clean, that is their own, so they can wear that, whether they want to wear that this season or a season in the future. But you don't want to invest heavily into anything right away until you know you're confident that they're going to be into it. And I do want to mention, the longer in the sport, you typically have guns lying around, or you have friends who have guns lying around that can lend it to them. But there's nothing wrong with starting out with a rental marker and getting them into the sport and see if they really love it before they jump right into it.
Mike Thompson goes a different direction. He says a cup. That's actually a really good idea.
For drinking? Just to make sure that you have a adequate hydration.
As long as he has two girls with it, he's fine.
Why would you go there? This was a quality program before.
No, it wasn't. There was
sorry, Maureen.
It was of a quality.
Of a quality.
Of a quality. Who else was it? Someone else had said EMEC. EMEC in the chat is a great gun as well.
Yeah.
Be easy to maintain, not much to do with it. Yeah, good job. And Brian Foster says mask first for sure. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
If you win a lottery and you want to get your kid into something, get him an MG100. But if you're just starting out, to make sure he or she is keen or they are keen on playing paintball, then I would say the Stormer Elite would be an excellent choice.
Josh, what about you, my friend? You've been pretty quiet on the subject.
Well, I fully agree with Gavin when he said go with the mask. Make sure that the mask fits really well. It's got a good snug feel. It's comfortable. I find that is going to help your kid enjoy the day a lot more than, you know, what markers in their hand. They don't really know kind of what's good and what's bad as of yet. And I had to ask around for some friends first and see if anybody's got something they're willing to part with for, you know, a decent price or something like that first, before you go and buy an all brand new marker and find out, you know, next season that your son or daughter doesn't want to play anymore. So I definitely say hit up the mask, try a whole bunch on, don't go by price, don't go by what everyone tells you is their favorite or the top number one selling one. Buy one that fits, and it's comfortable, and then go from there.
Yeah. Yeah, would you buy a pad, while you're talking about apparel, would you buy him a padded vest or a tactical vest just to help out the kidneys and the hits?
If it's not available for rental, absolutely. You want to make sure the experience is enjoyable, and they want to replicate that. They want to come back again, right? And so whatever protection you can add to that, that's great. Like neck protector or
elbow
bandanas.
Elbow pads all the way down to the forearm. That way their entire arm and torso is protected. That's one bad experience and your little friend's not coming back, right?
That's right.
Not,
you know, that age. As a parent who brought a little person out, which was essentially bubble wrapped and Nerf and you know, styrofoam, the whole bit, because, you know, I was a super anxious parent, wanting to make sure that the experience was great for her. it didn't quite work out, didn't catch, but at least she played. Yeah. But
your daughter did really well when she first came out, and you could tell she was a little more hardy, and like she had a couple of bad experiences, but worked through it and played it. My daughter came out and played about the same time and had a good experience until you yelled at her, and now she doesn't play anymore. But
well, you know, those hoppers, they're not going to kick themselves. And so when she was
with a splat master.
Yeah, you know, she was eating sandwiches at the time, and I just kicked the sandwich out of her hand too, just to get used to it.
So, Dad, are all paintballers like this?
It's also recommended that you don't shoot your son or daughter in the back of the head, apparently, when they're playing.
Or maybe is it, because out of all the kids who still continue to play, the one who got shot in the back of the head,
he still continues to play.
Well, that's the brain injury, right? He doesn't remember the game has ended. So.
That's nice.
All right. Next question comes to us from Matt Shook, and he wants to know, with the industry promoting lower ages, do you think they'll ever make a true youth goggle? Youth goggles can be found in many other sports, from the ski industry to motocross. And as a field owner, he has to ask he's been asking for this for years. What is the cost of developing a youth mask, and you know, is that cheaper than a lawsuit, really? Why isn't there a youth mask, essentially?
It's not a big enough market. I mean, there are some companies that are making them, right, Joe? But, like, it's...
There are. I used to really like the JT Elite goggles because they were small and they fit well. But I've found that the V4 Century fits quite well, fits most kids, and the only thing it needs is a little bit of silicone on the strap to keep it from slipping off little Johnny's heads. But we found that we had good luck this year with the Sentries, and once we got out of the lockdown we had a pretty high number of little kids that were playing. I guess families were coming out because they were looking for something to do, so we had a pretty broad mix of different size people, you know, heads playing paintball, and those fit quite well. And we did find another brand that fits smaller heads pretty well and doesn't fog as well.
Miss the X-rays. They were just solid plastic all the way around, but they were heavy and clunky, but they certainly protected you.
I think there has to be a variety of masks to fit different size face. Just because you're an adult doesn't necessarily mean you're going to have all the same size melon, right? And so it's important to have a variety within the industry to accommodate different head sizes, different face sizes. So I don't think it necessarily has to be youth specific. And why I think it's not advantageous for them to do it, as Todd mentioned, there's not a large market for it. And you know, if a kid gets into it and they have a proper fitting masks that, you know, that is comfortable for them, the sort of the longevity of that or having that mask system can only last for so long because of the way the melons grow, right? Kids grow, and so I don't think you know, in terms of the tooling of it and the market for it lends itself to that, but I do think there should be variety in terms of the sizes of masks, some a little more snug, some a little more robust and accommodating. So I think there, you know, hopefully there's some potential there for the industry to look at that rather than having sort of a cookie cutter. This is what's going to fit on your face and find ways to make accommodations to it. So I'm really hoping that, you know, with the growth of at least in our area, we saw a lot of kids and we saw a lot of females playing as well with smaller face structures, that they will have some more offerings for goggle systems so that, you know, people can get into it.
And there are we have certain guests from different parts of the world, and their facial bone structure is different, and sometimes it's very difficult to find a mask that gives them a good seal and fits well. So we do have a variety of masks, so when you can sort of, when someone comes up to get their equipment, you can sort of have an idea what they're getting and sort of give them the mask that looks like it will fit their face just from your experience. But we also have glasses, goggles that are eyeglass compatible. Some people are wearing eyeglasses. Not if someone comes up with their Oakleys, they just want to wear them for sun. But if someone's actually wearing prescription eyeglasses, then we do have eyewear that is compatible with those as well.
I seem to recall at one point a certain gentleman used to hang around Flag Riders quite a lot, who used to go on and on about these goggle or sunglass manufacturer companies that starts with an O, and they used to make an Asian fit one. And I thought that was kind of interesting how they had that market. They knew head size was a little smaller. I guess we just need the entire Asian continent to drop airsoft and pick up paintball and we should be good.
That's true.
Just that simple, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah.
It's that easy. It's not hard. It's a simple solution, but it's a mountain of a molehill.
Yeah.
All right. And Jeffrey Hinkson wants to know, he said, if Tippmann is bringing back the Phenom, will they also start making gun model conversions accessories as well? I think the best answer for me would be,
I don't know. I haven't. I just.
What
I
do you, Scooby
Doo? Shaggy. I heard that Tippmann was bringing back the Phenom late fall. My suspicions are, if they're bringing it back, they would still have the molds and they would still have the patents. So I would suspect that they could probably bring back. It was one of their best sellers. I would suspect they would bring back stocks and barrels and shrouds because people like to modify, customize, and trick out their stuff. And it gives Zuby a segment.
We've said this before, and I know, but guys, back in the day, back 15 years ago, you used to be able to buy a paintball gun, and any gun that you bought, there was a whole wall of accessories for them. You know, like you could buy a gun that was a base gun, whether it was an autococker, a Prun, a Spider, a Tippmann. Hell, Tippmanns. Remember how many aftermarket products there were for Tippmanns? You could buy that and have an awesome looking, paintball gun after the fact. And you have fun building them and doing that. Now, I mean, there are some guns with some accessories, but they're not to sound like that guy, but it ain't like what it used to be. You know, I miss those days. But sorry, I was ranting.
2007 paintball. 2007 paintball peaked, and it's been, you know, on a reasonable decline. I think in the last couple of years it's stabilized, and I think last year we saw an uptick. And you know, if we can somehow beat this pandemic situation and, you know, come out of it healthy and safe, and the economy is reasonably strong, I think you'll see paintball return. Maybe not to 2007 numbers, but you know, I think you'll see a resurgence as people are wanting to get outdoors, do stuff with their friends and family. So, yeah. Well.
I'm going to read this before it passes too far. We asked earlier in the show, and we're going to ask you guys for next week's show, who would be our replacements if we were to make a Behind the Bunker movie? And Adam Picard posted up, and I think he's pretty flattering to most of you guys. He says, Joe would be Bruce Willis. Josh would be Jack Black. Gavin, Keegan-Michael. Okay, yeah. And then Robert Downey Jr. Where do I get Robert Downey Jr.? That's... I guess that's pretty good. I'm flattered. But good for you. We'll ask you guys next week for the next week's show, and we'll see where that comes up with. I'm afraid that there's going to be some pretty bad casting.
Can only get better, I'm telling you that.
Awesome. But that's the best part about it.
Yeah. I want Sharon Stone to play me. Then I can recreate that scene with my croc jocks, or whatever they are.
Nice. Yeah. All right. You know what? How about I do a couple more questions, and then we can wrap up my sack. Yeah. All right. So the first one comes to us from, or the next one comes to us from Garrett Green. He wants to say, in the spirit of Valentine's, what are the best ways to encourage more female players to play and commit to the sport? So how can we both encourage the female persuasion to join us, and how do we keep them in the sport?
So in the spirit of Valentine's, how do we get more women out to the field so we can shoot them?
Okay, it's don't weird. Don't dissect the question. Just answer it as is.
I don't know what else we can do, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I mean, I have a shower and gussy myself up before each show, and I picked, you know, three other of the handsomest fellows I know. If this isn't bringing the ladies into paintball, I don't know what is. Robert Downey Jr. Yeah.
So I think, in all honesty, you have to create a culture of safety as well, right? So the last thing, you know, well, you know, maybe that's appealing too, but the last thing people want to do is just be oogled and you know, like the knuckle-dragging mouth breathers who are, any female that comes out and they're just all over them, right? So it doesn't make it lend itself to a welcoming environment.
Wait, there's a chance that I could take my shirt off here and strut around the staging area.
in my paintball underwear.
It is a male-dominated sport at this point. but, you know, you got to remember, is it safe for kids? Is it safe for partners to come out as well, right? So if you're worried about the company that you keep at the field, then, you know, that's not going to be warm and inviting. So is there a safe place for people to explore the game? Is there a safe place for people to ask questions? Or is there a Johnny Know-It-All who's going to take the lead and you know, be really, really aggressive in terms of this is the sport of paintball and you have to like it and can I get your phone number, right? Yeah. So
selling Axe body spray at the concessions is probably not a good idea.
No, it'll be, you know, I would encourage that for many of the participants of the sport, but... But really, so, I mean, you know, Flag Raiders, it does lend itself to a lot of birthday parties, a lot of team building as well, right? And so what can you do to help people feel comfortable to be there, right? That little Johnny or little Sarah to play. So it is the PR work, it is the hand-holding, it is the, you know, this is safe. You know what, and we've seen this too, you know, in the growth of at least Flag Raiders and the sport. It's a mom may come out with her kid, who may be a member or may not be a member, but it's how can we get them, you know, interested in participating with their child as well,
yeah,
right?
For sure.
So, you know, there are a number of people who just come out once or twice. There are a number of women who come out once or twice, but how can you make it safe, fun, and enjoyable for them? And I know one of the promotions that Flag Raiders did a number of years ago was a ladies' night. Now this is ladies' night. You know, something a little bit less intimidating, where you're playing with other like-minded people, and you don't have to worry about being shot up, right? It's just people who are interested in the sport, but not intimidated because you're playing with pairs or other new people as well. So yeah. I think explore some of that. So Joseph has the floor right now.
And then we've found that in the last two or three years, there've been lots of couples coming out to play paintball, and we've really, when these type of groups have come out, we really push them to play low impact, even though some of the guys in the group may have their own equipment and such. We've really pushed those particular groups to play low impact as to not, you know, have people shot, you know, so it hurts, to try to perpetuate and grow the sport a bit. So we've really pushed the low impact aspect. So that it's something if you're running a field and you see one of these sort of mixed groups come in, even though someone has their own equipment, you know, try to push and suggest low impact as paintball. Just, you know, if it's everyone's first time and they may not be dressed for the traditional 68 caliber paintball, so push low impact if you can, and I think, you know, people get pretty good buy-in.
Hey, in the live chat as well, Lisa Weber, she's a girl, says don't treat the girls like lesser players.
Exactly.
And Maureen Brown says too many think that we shouldn't be taken seriously, and that's true. I mean, there are some, you know, some aggressive players and players that are girls that have played quite a bit. And then Elliot Darno wants to take a bit of a jab at Zuby. He says mouth breathers are people too, Josh.
No, they're not.
But, you know, we in the last year and a half, we've got there's two or three moms that have been playing pretty regular with their kids, and there's a couple. Brooke and her friend have been playing pretty regularly. Brooke brings her mom out and stuff like that. So, like, there is, I think you have to set the stage and be welcoming, like everyone has said, to encourage people to play paintball and be just part of the gang. Yep. An equal, if you will.
Precisely. Are you blending in? Like, are you standing out? Like, it's like, you know what? People want to have a good time. So how can we help them have a good time? Can they feel safe? Can they feel comfortable? Can they explore and grow in the sport? And I think that's up to the field owner and that's up to the staff that are at the field and the members who are there to make sure that everybody's having a great experience, regardless of your gender, regardless of your experience level. You know, everybody who walks on the field is going to be a potential member or future player. So let's make sure that everybody has a great time when they're out.
Yeah, for sure.
That's the beauty about paintball, though, right? It's literally a great equalizer. How many times you're out on the field, you see, you know, grandpa, father and son, or you see daughter and mom, you see everybody's out there, everybody shoots 280, everyone has the same paint, everyone's all there. It's, you know, it is equal for everyone. That's one of the greatest parts about it. And whenever people ask about it, that's what I say. It's like, look, you can be the biggest, strongest, fastest person in the world. But guess what? You're not outrunning a paintball.
Yep.
You know what? I will cinch up my sack on that lovely note.
Try as hard as Gavin does, you cannot outrun paintballs.
That's right.
And Mike Grizzly Grub on YouTube, Gavin, one last point, says women can pull a trigger just as easy as a guy can.
100%, right? So make sure it's in a welcoming environment for all genders and for all ages as well, because again, this sport only grows and we can only thrive when we're all in this together, right? So I just want to make sure, you know, we remind each other that we're all in this together. So let's all support each other and grow the sport one person at a time. And what can you do each and every time you're out of the field? Make sure you make that experience something exceptional for somebody else as well. Yep. So I'm going to set you up my sack, and if you have any questions or queries that you'd like addressed in the mail time, send it to showbehindthebunker.com or post on the social medias, and we can address it here on Mail Time.
Mail Time.
Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, thank you to all of you guys that are watching right now. It means a lot that you guys are here. Thank you. If you guys are watching us on YouTube, please hit that like button. Make a comment, even subscribe if you want to take our relationship to the next level. Facebook, if you guys are watching us there, please hit that like and share. Hey, if you could share this to any of your paintball groups or your friends, that would be awesome. Awesome, yes, but maybe not as awesome as Planet Eclipse, guys. Did you know that Planet Eclipse has more championships, new mechanical markers, new electronics, new territory, including their new MagFed division? Get Planet Eclipse, guys, and well, take on the world.
When the world's greatest players, photographers, and expected parents need the best coverage, most vivid colors, biggest selection, they pull a tab on an EG product. Hashtag Pop Smoke.
Thick welded seam, stainless steel hardware, multiple color options makes Air Ups the number one choice for inflatables on and off the field. Made in America by Brent Davis and his crew, airups.com.
Yeah, this is me losing my read again for this week.
How?
It's on my camera roll, and I never mind. I found it.
Yeah.
Dreams fade. Ruthless paintball products, colors, sublimation, and craftsmanship never die on or off the field. Ruthless keeps you fresh. Use the promo code BTB15 for 15% off your order.
Adapt, create, and win. Exalt is in our blood. In fact, it is our blood type. So make your game boil. Get Exalt, which is available worldwide.
From the beginning, you'd stumble down a rocky cliff or wade chest deep through a mosquito-infested bog. Now, whether you're sliding into the snake or running and gunning, GI Sports has a gear for you. Now with the Stormer, Stormer Basic, Stormer Elite, and Stormer Tactical. Booyah!
DLX Technologies, guys. True industry innovators with some of the lightest, fastest, sleekest hardware in paintball. DLX has the power to get you to the podium, guys, and the podium is where you want to be. If you guys are watching us right now, please go ahead and tag any of your favorite sponsors of our show. It would help us a lot.
Hey guys, Todd from Behind the Bunker. It is that time of the month again. I get my blue bag in the mail from PB Swag. PB Swag, guys, is a monthly service that gets mailed to you that's full of things that you like that's paintball related, like this. A nice green podgy from Exalt. Something everybody needs all the time is an Exalt squeegee, Exalt swab, and what is this? Oh, look at that, a large microfiber goggle cloth for putting in the pit for when you guys are playing. That's pretty cool. So check that out, ladies and gentlemen. A blue bag comes to your house every week from PB Swag. Order yours today.
What I love to do most on the field is get really, really close. The ability to play anywhere on the field, to be able to make bunkers that are at the 50s, really to use my speed as a weapon. I think the friendships that I've made with players, with teams, with companies, for me, that's the biggest takeaway from paintball. It's a character builder, man. The sport itself, the people, it molds people and it builds people. And that's exactly what it's done to me. I love the opportunity that Bruno gave to me. I love the teammates that I've had. I'm super proud to wear this jersey. and to play for a Midwest team. And I know I played my heart out as well as all my teammates, and I wouldn't trade it for the world. My name is Carl Markowski, and I play for Chicago Aftershock.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for continuing your patience with the show and watching tonight. We appreciate you guys doing so. We want to talk about something in the sport of paintball, and we're going to watch you guys in on the YouTube chat as well as our Facebook chat. If you guys have a comment, put it up. We're going to try to read it on the show right now. The question is, what other sports did you quit or were you doing when you found paintball? We put it out on our social media. A lot of guys have went and posted up. Like James Poole said, he didn't quit. He rather just put more money into paintball and shiny things because he couldn't afford to put it anywhere else. Gavin, we're gonna let's talk to you in here in just a second. I want to find out what you were doing before you found paintball. Martin says lacrosse was his go-to. His body was starting to show self-inflicted damage from all of his aggression. Yeah, so he's no longer doing that. What about you, Gavin? What were you doing before you did paintball?
Well, Todd, thank you for asking. yeah, you know what? Not a whole lot. I mean, it was a different time in my life, so I had abandoned sort of the regular house league type stuff, you know, into my young adult life. But I was doing a lot of fishing, angling, yeah. You know, pretty heavily. And it's still, you know, a small part of my life, but, you know, paint it, you know, whatever I did, whether it was house league stuff or sort of co-op or rec sort of pickup games of anything, I didn't, paintball never, paintball had the bite and nothing else did. So, you know, it wasn't a, you know, I'm not grieving anything that I, you know, turned my back on. And I almost exclusively do paintball versus any other sport or activity. So, you know what, yeah. I gave up, not a lot, really. I didn't lose anything. I just gained. And that's all I have to say.
Tommy Gunn said he had to split his weekends between baseball and paintball. Jason Diff said badminton. The rush just wasn't there after paintball. And David Justice Reaper said stand-up comedian. Or stand-up comedy, rather.
Funny guy. Bob Spicer, I gave up motocross for paintball, paintball for tournament bass fishing, and fishing has taken a backseat again. For paintball.
George Hayes says he's given up shaving. Good for you, George.
Good one, George.
Pete Russell.
Shaving where?
Yeah.
Let's move on.
Pete Russell says
underwear.
Surfing, fishing, and beach life. Pete gave up. Dylan said fishing and hockey. Same with Rick, but he said fishing and shooting. Rob Walker says basically he's given up all of them. Now, you were Eric Engler, a friend of the show. I'm going to let you guys predict it unless you've read it already. What do you think Eric Engler gave up as a sport before he took on paintball?
Speedboat racing.
So you've read it already.
No.
No, I remember doing pictures.
Okay.
That's a common misnomer with Eric. He was much, much into the speedboat racing, but it's a little known fact that he is actually a world champion bocce ball player.
Oh yeah,
gave it all up just for paintball.
Well, he said that it was hydroplane racing, but I believe that he meant to say smuggling drugs in a cigarette boat is basically what his boating experience was.
I heard Miami Vice is loosely based off his life.
Well, that's how he used to wear his pastel shirts, and I think they just picked up on that. Bobby Doust says I was a pro BMX freestyler. Nice.
That's cool.
Little Wolfie Critchlow in the chat said golf. He gave up golf. I can understand why paintball had such a hold on you.
Mike Thompson says when paintball starts when golf becomes too frustrating each season. So looks like he starts off swinging and then he comes out shooting.
Kevin Goat says he's gave up his dignity.
Yes, sir.
Good for
we
you.
We all have.
Good for you. Joe, what were you doing before you found paintball? Did you do any sort of sports or hobbies or?
I skied in the winter, but I think I had motocross stuff, I think.
You did some golfing as well because in your shed you had some golf clubs there.
I had some golf clubs, yeah. But the golfing was, that was in the early 90s. I did some golfing, mid-90s. So I think, I don't know, motocross, I guess, sort of thing.
Yeah. Josh, you were... I know you're a ref for hockey, but did you play hockey?
Yeah. Didn't really give up that while playing paintball, because that generally took place during the weekdays, in the evening, when, you know, sort of the field isn't closed. So I, if anything, I cut back on golf to play a little bit more paintball, but I don't think I actually gave up anything.
Someday someone will have to explain
other than oodles of money.
But you guys will have to explain someday why golf has such a hold on people. Maybe it's a personal thing. I've played golf a handful of times. I've never gotten bit by that bug, but.
Oh, dear God. My whole family's into golf. Yeah. My daughter is exceptional at it. I can't swing the wrenches at all. I have no natural
swing
ability.
Swing the wrenches. Just, listen to you.
That's right. You know what? I am a really good caddy. I can drive the cart and I can drink beer. And, you know, my daughter's okay with that. So that's
all
my
of
role.
Gavin's family owns golf clubs. Gavin has golf bats.
Give me one of them sticks. Let me hit the ball.
Does he golf?
Yeah, he's a really good golfer too. So I mean, you know, clearly it skips a generation.
So, I heard he moved out to the middle of nowhere to be closer to Foxwood, but I didn't know if that was a rumor or not.
Yeah, he's into the golfs and the softs balls.
Yeah, he's a softball guy.
Yes, wow. Not so much paintball.
Ew.
Jesse LeBray says he gave up skateboarding and skateboarding. Yeah, paintball's not a cheap sport. I mean, most of the sports you guys are talking about, I mean, golf, yes, the clubs are expensive, the membership expensive, but at least that's it. Then you're not really paying for much after that.
Green fees are expensive.
I guess.
But
yeah.
You know what?
It's honestly comparable to paintball.
Really?
Honestly, yeah.
Plus, I guess you got to wear those, you got to buy those nasty pants. You can't golf in normal pants.
How are you going to make fun of golf pants when you play speedball, Todd?
If you play your cards right, Todd, you can wear the same pants for golf as you wear for paintball. Just you have to play speedball because they're all bright and ugly.
Oh, yes. Raheem Bricktop Jones says he was a dancer. Now, breakdancing doesn't count, does it?
I was curious if he was a private dancer. A dancer for money.
I remember he used to keep asking me for my my refrigerator boxes, and he would take it out to the local parking lot and with his big ghetto blaster. And God, I used to break dance when I was a kid. That's how old we are. Jesus. Oh well.
I was break dancing today in the backyard, but it was ice and not on purpose.
The producer of the show, Matt, he gave up championship chess. He was right up there.
Bobby Fischer?
No, the King's Gambit.
That was his performing name, Gavin. Yeah. Yeah. I think that's all I have right now in my sheets. We're also getting close to the end of the show here, ladies and gentlemen. If you guys are watching on YouTube, stay with us. We're gonna say goodbye to our Facebook friends, and we're gonna continue to record our after show / podcast. If you guys are watching us on Facebook, thank you for watching us. Please, on your way out, hit that like and share button. Share it to any of your paintball groups. If you have any subgroups, definitely let them know that we exist. And if you don't have the ability to sit and listen to us all hour on Facebook and YouTube, find us anywhere you get your favorite podcast from, ladies and gentlemen. We're on all of the media platforms, and we can be downloaded right to your phone or smart device, and you can listen to us while you're at work, school, play, whatever you guys are going to do. Thank you, Joe, for being on the pre-show.
Thanks, everyone, for tuning in tonight and watching, and we'll see you on the after show on YouTube. Until then, pew pew.
And Josh Zubizabrikas.
Yeah, thanks for coming, folks. And thank you to all 93 people who shared. That's quite
nice.
Awesome.
Thank you, guys.
I know we ask every week, and yes, it does make a big difference. And don't forget to help control your local airsoft population. Have your local airsofters spayed or neutered.
Very good. And thank you, Gavin, for your mail time segment tonight.
Yeah, always great to be here, and I appreciate everybody who sends in contributions to the mail time segment, whether through social media or sending in emails as well. We sincerely appreciate your contributions. We sincerely appreciate your interactions in the chat, and we will definitely catch you next week. And if you are so inclined, slide over to YouTube, and we will continue the show.
If you can't slide into Gavin's DMs, you can at least slide into the YouTubes.
Indeed.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, farewell to you guys on Facebook. We'll see you in just a moment on our podcast and on YouTube.
Don't be a freeloader. If you liked what you hear, make sure to hit the share button below. Also follow us on our social media outlets like Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, ICQ, and now MySpace. If you want to join the conversation, post your comments and we might read them on the show.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are back. If you guys are listening to our podcast, thank you so much for tuning in and downloading our show. I have no idea, as I said in the pre-show, where all of you guys are coming from. Australia had a huge uptick. And I don't know if a couple of the major media sites down there shared us this week, but whoever did, crikey. Thank you very much. We appreciate it.
And they're in lockdown as well, so it may be part of their punishment. Right, so
yeah,
it's not quality entertainment, but people just starve for anything else. So.
I don't know what it is, but there's the shows on Netflix about people going to prison and stuff, like prison documentaries. There's one where this guy goes, he goes to prison for 2 weeks, and they film it and everything like that. He went to an Australian prison a couple weeks ago. Wow, that was horrible. I think the show's called Deadliest Prisons or something like that.
Milo's been following that and telling me about it. He's been watching it on YouTube and watching all these different prisons where the guy's been going to.
It's nasty. It's really nasty. So I have a question for you. We were talking about horrible golf pants. Okay, you guys have seen the movie Gentleman, right? And
The Gentleman?
I haven't seen it.
Okay, so Guy Ritchie, he leads a gang of thugs, but they're not really thugs. Like he's trying to teach them good and teach them right, and they're like a fighting club, right? Do you remember the ensembles they wore, Gavin? They were like plaid print, yeah, like a full plaid tracksuit. Yeah. I found a company that makes those.
And why would you look for this stuff, Todd?
Someone I follow on Instagram, Bert Kreischer, last week posted that he bought one and he was wearing it, and it just looked awesome. Now, granted, he already has a gold chain and he's already got the hairy chest, but would you consider buying one of those? I'm wondering if that's this year when we step foot at our first paintball event when the pandemic's over. I want all four of us in matching, not matching because we have to have different prints, but same suits, right, just different patterns.
Well, will that be a hit? I absolutely think, you know, when the world opens up, something comfortable, because you know what? There's some COVID weight gain that's happened, right? And so, you know what? That elastic band is it's forgiving, and you know, it can hide some of the grief eating and in drinking that's happened. So, will that happen? You know, potentially. You know what? We'll all have a comfortable, draped in gabardine. Velvet. It'll be wonderful. Yeah.
Jesus.
I'm down.
I'm going to see if I can find... I don't know if I'm going to be able to find an image of it, but if
you
I
know
can...
What suit are you talking about, sorry?
I'll show it to you. It's like a full track suit, but it's what they wore in the Gentleman movie, where the thugs were wearing all those matching one-piece track... Or not one-piece, but like full matching track suits.
Oh.
Yeah. I can't
find the one suit that I really like to own that I know you're not, like, you can't order, you can't buy it. Because Lululemon made a suit for a guy for his wedding.
Nice.
And it was a one-off type thing. I don't know why they did it, but like, I keep looking at it, I'm like, man, that would be awesome. If you could walk into a meeting just wearing all Lululemon suit, I'd be so happy.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
And if Matt will post up the picture on the screen there, you guys can see it at home. I'm sorry, that's all I've got.
Oh, that's the guys from the boxing gym.
Yes. But wouldn't that be awesome?
Oh yeah, I'd rock that. I'd rock no problem.
Oh yeah.
Connor Bryant in the YouTube chat says he's actually had his paintball pants altered for his COVID gains. So.
Well, I'm glad it's not just me. Sure. With all the walking and everything that I've done, that I've been doing lately because being locked in, you'd think I'd be losing the weight, but it's just the constant eating. You're stuck at home with all the food around you. Yeah. So we're going to ask you guys this week. We'll post up on our social media platforms. We want to know if we make a social or if we make a paintball documentary about us or a paintball movie, who would play us? Who would play us? And here's the thing. I want you guys listening to the podcast at home to really think about that too, because you guys, for those of you that don't watch the show, that just download and listen to it, maybe you don't even know what we look like. Who do you imagine us to be? That would be right. A great thing. Like, there was a couple of people that I listened to his podcast, and a couple of weeks in, I went and actually Googled it because I wanted to know what they look like, and I was way off. Not even close.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
So I would like to extend this a little bit more, Todd.
Yeah.
So in addition to the cast, what would the storyline be? What would the arc be? What would we be doing as BTB?
Give us a plot line.
Would we be solving mysteries? Would we be like, what is going on?
Yeah.
Please let us know the cast and what the storyline would be.
That's fine.
I am really excited about this.
Yeah. If we were the Three's Company, I would want to be Chrissy. Yeah. I'm already.
Dude, I don't want to unpack that at all. I'll be Jack. I'm cool with being Jack.
If I was Chrissy, I wouldn't want you to unpack either. So. Oh well.
What show are you talking about?
Three's Company.
Three's Company.
Come on, knock on my door.
Really?
All right.
No,
Who's watching YouTube right now that does not know Three's Company? Please post up. And you know what? I know it's an age thing. I know I probably have a couple of months on Josh, but I thought everybody watched Three's Company.
Three's Company? No.
Regal Beagle?
Come on. I'm looking it up.
All right. And you know, I do have to make apologies over the last few weeks to our YouTube friends. So the live chat doesn't remain in terms of what's the commentary that goes on there. So I read a lot, but I don't have the opportunity to respond. So I do appreciate I'm watching, and I do appreciate you guys contributing in the YouTube live chat. But when it goes, when it's uploaded, it all disappears. So
now,
ignoring you.
Now here's the thing, Gavin. I researched that today to find out why and how, and there are settings, but because it's a live stream. You can comment after the show and post it up because we do get comments after the show. But if you watch our video right now in Rewind, the chat will actually come up as it populates when you're watching it live.
Okay.
So if you go back and rewatch the whole show, those chats will come back up. But if you're just watching the show after the fact, then you can comment on the wall and hit that like button, all that sort of great stuff. So
because I do that on Facebook. Where I go back and watch the show again and comment for all the things I've missed, but I haven't seen that on YouTube yet, so I will certainly try that as well.
Yeah, Lisa Weber knows who Mr. Furley is, and Bobby Dowse says Janet was hot. Yeah, I'm more of a Chrissy than a Janet, but good for you. Yeah, it doesn't look like many other people know that, so we won't bring up Three's Company references anymore.
I looked it up on YouTube, and judging by the decor and the clothes that they're wearing, I was much too young to remember it. But.
Yeah, and it was in reruns when I was watching, I'm sure, too, because that was a fairly old show. All right, here's the problem, ladies and gentlemen. There is a storm a-brewing outside, and we all need to get everything done here and locked away before this storm hits us. We're due any minute, and I'm afraid our internet's going to crap out. So we're going to cut our losses now and probably say farewell. That way we can avoid any sort of disruption in the show. So thank you to all of you guys who have been watching us on YouTube, and thank you to all of you guys that are downloading us as a podcast. And for those listening in Australia that found us, someone tell me where that came from or who shared it or how come there was so many likes there. Jason Diff already says Bert Kreischer plays Josh Zubizabrikas.
All right.
I would accept that.
Do you know that Josh took a job in the Russian mafia once?
Yeah, they called me the machine.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, Joe, thank you again for being on the show.
Thanks, everyone, for tuning in tonight, and we'll see you next week.
Gavin?
Great to be here. Thank you again for your support of this program, and we'll definitely catch you guys next week.
Bert?
Thanks for tuning in, everybody, and thank you for Jason for the Bert Kreischer. Oh, I like that one.
There we go. Thanks, guys, for listening. We'll see you next week. Hello, and welcome to Behind the Bunker. If you like tonight's show, It has turned into a podcast, and you can find hundreds of them at Apple Podcast or through Spotify or any other podcast platform in the known universe. If you want to watch tonight's show, go to YouTube and launch a search. They are all there. We release a new podcast every Monday night at 8 p.m. If you want to hit up the show, reach us by email at show@behindthebunker.com, and you can also find us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Tonight's podcast was produced by Matt the Crypt. Show's sponsors are Planet Eclipse, Enola Gay, Air Ups, Ruthless, Exalt, GI Sports, and DLX. I'm Todd Ansich. Thanks for listening.